Hello, Captains. It's Rami Summers again, and on my free-to-play playthrough of Star Trek Online, we are working our way through the Iconian War currently. As I mentioned I would do, I have replayed, so far, I have replayed House Peg in order to get the remaining space and ground traits that mission offers, so I now have all the rewards from House Peg. I still need to replay Time in a Bottle and Broken Circle to get everything from those two missions, but I will do that. But now it's time to start another new mission. Let's get into Butterfly. This one is quite fun. This is a very fun mission and very involved, in fact. So pay close attention because the things that happen in this mission right here are the cause for why Future Proof exists and the temporal Cold War. That's right. So very, very interesting stuff. Also, we are only one mission away from the final mission of the Iconian War, so we're nearing the end of that storyline. The research teams in the Kiana system have been running thousands of temporal incursion simulations of how to use the Krennum weapon. We need an officer with field experience to evaluate the most promising options and their feasibility. Meet with Captain Nog on board the research lab to discuss our best course of action.
The research teams in the Kiana system require your assistance. They have been running thousands of temporal incursion simulations of how to use the Krennum weapon. But I need an officer with field experience to evaluate the project and its feasibility. You will participate in a focus test of the most promising options. A blade cuts both ways. We must be sure that what this weapon can do to the Iconians does not cause greater harm to us.
Okay, report to the Kiana system. We get focusing assault training manuals, a temporal disentanglement suite. This is one of the consoles I've been waiting to get. I'll show you guys why at the end. A temporal phase overcharge warp core, part of the Krennum temporal manipulation set if we want to go down that route. Temporal phase overcharge singularity core, that's if you're a Romulan. And the omnidirectional anti-chronoton infused tetrion beam that I've been waiting for to put on the back of my ship. And then a tetrion turret as well if we wanted that for the set. And then a chronoton torpedo if we just wanted one. So there's a lot of good things in this mission, and I'll definitely be having to repeat it in order to get all the rewards I want. But we'll go over all that at the end, and we'll see what will work best for my ship. Let's accept the mission. There is just one thing I want to check out really quick, if you don't mind. I thought that it sounded like the voice volume sounded low to me, so I don't know, that was weird. Okay, well, whatever. It looks like it's all okay. Alright, let's just go straight to the mission. Begin Butterfly. So now we can see the anoraks at the research station.
Welcome. We have been working with the Krennum to build both this facility and a weapon similar to the one developed by anoraks in the 22nd century. Captain Nog is running point for the Alliance, but teams from all across the Alpha and Beta quadrants are involved with the research. It's fascinating work, but there's a lot to do yet.
How can I help?
Captain Nog might be able to explain more. He's waiting for you.
All right, let's go speak to Nog, please. The station has changed too. It's now a darker color. They finally, I guess, finished it. Here we go, everybody. Temporal research. Oh, well, she's not going to take me straight to Nog. She's just going to go to her console, okay?
I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances. We've managed to make a prototype of the Krennum weapon in Anorax's records, but we have not attempted to use it yet. Time isn't something you mess around with, So we have been conducting simulations here of possible incursions, as well as developing new ways to protect and store data on various timelines.
So this is going to be a very dialogue-y episode, most likely, so stay tuned for that. I am going to go over all the dialogue, though I don't want to miss any important plot points, so just sit back and relax. Let's see, can you explain the process to me? How is this different from going back in time, changing something, and creating an alternate timeline? What about just removing the Iconians from the time stream? Sela said something about Iconians and time travel. Is that important? And protect what we know? A lot of things here. Well, yes. Why don't we just remove the Iconians from the time stream? Wouldn't that solve the problem?
That was the first simulation we tried. The results were fairly catastrophic.
Oh, really?
Without the Iconians, the first development of warp technology by other cultures in the Alpha Quadrant is severely delayed. By about 50,000 years.
Really?
Removing the Iconians would change everything we know.
We would eventually develop warp travel, right?
Let me put it this way. In one version, the Daywans eventually rise to power and conquer most of the Beta Quadrant. They are forced back by the Vulcans, who never embrace logic, and later enslave much of what is now Federation and Klingon space.
I can see how that would be a problem.
I'm not done yet. The Herc never develop warp technology at all. So they never invade Kronos and unite the Klingons as a warrior culture. When the Vulcan Star Empire finds the Klingons in the 22nd century, they were mostly farmers who had made some advances in epic poetry. By the present day in this simulation, the Vulcan Star Empire is locked in a to-the-death struggle with the Dominion.
I get it. Removing the Iconians directly is a bad idea.
I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances.
Okay.
We've managed to make a prototype of the Krenim weapon in Anorak.
Sela said something about Iconians
use it yet.
And time travel.
Oh, that the Iconians can't time travel because it unravels their minds. She was being dramatic, but she was essentially correct. When most humanoids time travel, they retain the memories of their timeline of origin. So you realize when things have changed. Iconians are at least partially energy beings. You saw that when Matara was able to use her own power to open gateways. And their brain structure is very different from other humanoids. As far as we understand, if an Iconian traveled back in time, their mind and memories would reshape to fit that time. So they would retain no memories of the present. They don't use time travel because it would literally be taking a step backwards.
Ooh, okay.
I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances. We've managed to make a prototype of the Krenim weapon.
Explain the process,
Jimmy.
When
we talk about time alteration, we're specifically referring to the Krenim weapon's ability to remove something from time. Anything, from a single molecule to an entire civilization. It's as if the target of the weapon never existed at all.
So it doesn't just move something, it deletes it.
Correct. The changes ripple out from the incursion point and result in a new reality where the target no longer exists. This does mean that the ship must be able to fire on a target. The details are a bit more complex, of course, but that's the main difference from conventional time travel.
And no one has a problem with this?
Temporal agents from all three factions are watching everything we do carefully. That's one of the reasons we're running holodeck simulations first. Between you and me, I'm glad they're here. The Krenim are a little too eager to use the weapon. Time manipulation is a very delicate operation under the best of circumstances. We can't just start shooting things out of existence and hoping it all works out for the best. I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances. Once we make an incursion, anything not protected by a temporal shield will conform to the new timeline. That includes all of us once this mission is over. We won't remember the Iconians, the war, or anything that changes in the new timeline. Clouda has been leading the work to create a shielded computer core to hold all the data we currently have. A time capsule, I guess you'd call it.
The core needs to be shielded forever?
Correct. This isn't the sort of sacrifice we'd expect any personnel involved in the incursion to make. So we've built a computer to retain the information for us. We'll know what happened before, even though it essentially will have happened to someone else. I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances. We've tried a different number of scenarios, but only in the holodeck. Direct action against the Iconians is proving to be problematic, because so much time has passed since they were first a great power. Incursions that far back in time must be carefully planned, or the fallout of even minor changes can ripple across reality. We have, however, seen some promise in trying to delay their arrival.
But that's just delaying the inevitable.
Actually, it would be closer to a 700-year delay if our calculations are correct. The Iconians have had 200,000 years to build their fleets, but we're catching up to them. We've already seen what the 29th century technology can do. Imagine what we'll have in the 32nd century.
Yeah, good point. So we'd be on equal footing.
Exactly. The other potential solution is to cut into their current power base. What if the Iconians never allied with the Alachi or the Solanae? We wouldn't be facing the trouble we do now.
Okay.
The three most promising incursions each follow one of these tactics. My teams have been running simulations and refining their targets, but I'd like you to assist them using a special quantum recursive algorithm. Our simulators can run the outcome of a possible incursion on the holodeck. Interacting with that simulation will give us more data than just crunching the numbers. We need to really interact with it to see what reality would look like, and for that, I need someone like you with field experience.
Well, I'm not sure about changing time, but simulations can't hurt. So, very interesting here. What's this? This is, Sofin.
Hello. Please allow me to explain what we're doing here. We've determined that if we remove a specific series of stars from the Beta Quadrant in the distant past, a rogue planet will enter the Iconia system and cause massive geological damage at about the same time the planet was bombarded by the Iconians' enemies. The technological buildup of the orbital bombardment that destroyed the Iconian civilization will still happen, but the Iconians themselves will have to deal with a natural disaster, not a war.
Okay.
Maybe the survivors of a natural disaster, if there are any, won't be so vengeful. And none of the stars we will remove have planets with the possibility of developing life. The overall effect on the galaxy is minimal. It's a painful path, but it could be the one that leads to peace.
This seems rather extreme, doesn't it?
The number of stars we will have to remove is a concern. Which is why we're trying this in a simulation first. But as Captain Nog said, these simulations aren't perfect, so we have devised a holodeck program that will expand and extrapolate on possible effects of the temporal incursion.
You're giving a lot of weight to the holodeck.
It's the best option we have available to us. The holodeck's algorithms have been updated to change and adapt to the data created by the simulated timeline alteration. This is not your average holo novel.
All right, what do you need me to do?
Once we run the program, you'll be able to interact with our best approximation of the new timeline. Interaction with the holodeck components will allow the program to generate a more in-depth solution and give us a better idea of what to expect. We have set this simulation on a Federation starship patrolling the Sol system, and you are the captain. If all goes as planned, we expect that almost everything in the system should be close to current reality.
Well, I like the idea of delaying the Iconians, because if we can delay them to a time when we're able to deal with them, then that's much better, and we don't actually have to destroy people to do that. Well, this didn't go well. There's already fire.
Captain, you're alive! We repelled the intruders on the bridge, but the ship has taken heavy damage, and a lot of the crew are injured.
What's the situation?
Sir, I'm not sure this is the time. So many people are hurt, and most of the systems are offline. The life support is on backups, and our resources are down to nothing, and...
I'll help with the wounded, but you need to help me. What happened?
The Dominion stopped firing at us when we lost weapons. Now they're focusing on Earth's defense grid, but it's only a matter of time before they return to finish us off.
We'll stabilize the crew and fight back. This isn't over. The Dominion, huh?
Sir, I tried to fight them off, but the boarding parties, the Jem'Hadar. We have to stop the Dominion. They can't take Earth, too.
Don't worry, we'll stop them. But I wonder what made them more powerful.
I never expected they would get so far into our defenses. I'm sorry, Captain. I just need a moment. Then I'll be ready to fight.
Whenever you're ready.
We We can't stop them. Maybe if we hadn't been at war with the Romulans. Maybe if the Klingons hadn't ripped themselves apart. I'll be fine, Captain. Just rattled.
At war with the Romulans? Why are we at war with the Romulans?
Incoming hail!
USS Ajax, sensors show your ship is completely defenseless, and I would prefer not to delay our arrival at Earth to deal with such a minor annoyance. Surrender now, and I will guarantee the safety of your crew.
Never surrender. Well, let's see what's happened. I don't know why we're at war with the Romulans. Hull breaches, hull integrity bad, weapons bad, shields bad, life support bad. Quadrant casualty report. Betazoid, taken. Teller Prime, taken. Vulcan, uninhabitable. Captain's personal log. We haven't seen the bulk of the enemy fleet in 3 days, but their scouts continue to harass us. Vulcan is lost, and Doria is in flames. Romulus, Teller Prime, Beta Z, Trill, ashes. If the Romulans had joined us, maybe this would have been different. The Klingons barely had enough ships left to patrol their home system. They weren't a threat anymore. We were offering friendship, but the Romulans refused us. And then the Dominion came and took everything. Long-range sensors are offline. There is no Iconian activity in the immediate area. Download all the data. So somehow, we went to war with the Romulans because of the Iconians having to survive a disaster? That doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
Sorry, we were watching from the control room, and that could have gone better. Even with all that, the simulation data on whether the Iconians were entirely eliminated from that timeline is inconclusive. We were able to record your interactions, and we've been able to piece together what happened from those. From what we can piece together, the Klingon Empire was never unified by its conflicts against outsiders, and the great houses turned on one another instead. The Romulans took the chaos as an opportunity to attack. The Federation stepped in to help the Klingons, and the war between the three factions basically ripped the Quadrant apart. The Dominion then conquered all three weakened powers.
Dang. But I wonder what would have caused the Klingon Empire to never unify by its conflicts against outsiders. How would that have made a difference if the Iconia... I don't get how that affected the Klingons.
Agreed. My team will continue working on other possible incursion scenarios.
Okay, let's talk to somebody else. Noi.
Another one of you voyagers? I don't know how you can help, but very well. My team is working on scenarios that reduce the Iconian power base. We're attempting to do so by fixing a mistake that Janeway allowed to happen decades ago. We're going to stop the Vaadwar from being rediscovered. We plan to do this by preventing Voyager from ever coming into contact with Underspace. This will prevent them from finding Vaadwar Prime. And 7 of 9 will never wake the Vaadwar.
But that doesn't take away their Solanae and Alachi power base. Those two power bases are their main power base. The Vaadwar just did some jobs for them in the Delta Quadrant, which ultimately we defeated. They didn't make a big impact. It's the Solanae and the Alachi we need to take out. So I don't think this plan will work very well. And I suppose leaving the Vaadwar in stasis will help the Krynim, too. I don't know what you mean by Voyager. I never served on that ship.
No, but you're all the same. You come to our quadrant, meddle in affairs that don't concern you and that you don't understand, and leave chaos in your wake. Now you want us to help you alter time. Tell me, does that sound like something someone like you should be doing?
And you should. By the way, you came to us build this ship. You couldn't build it on your own, so you needed our help to build it. So you just step back there, Noi. Step back for a second. I'm not sure that power should be in your hands either.
None of us are going to survive if we don't try to repair the damage you've already done. The goal is to cause a solar flare that will force Voyager to divert from the course it was on when it stumbled into underspace. If it safely passes without entering underspace, it can continue on its trip home and bypass the Vadwar entirely. The simulation
we'll
is
see.
Set for the USS Voyager, which is fitting since they caused the problem in the first place. Our projections show that even if the Vadwar never return, your people will still find a reason to stick your noses into our business. So we're attempting to see how the elimination of the Vadwar will change the formation of the Delta Alliance. You will be a member of the diplomatic team.
I don't see how that fixes our Iconian problem. That is too current in the timeline. Well, let's see what happens. Oh, speak with researcher Claudia. Whoops. I was ready to get started. So here you go, everybody. This is an important character you want to pay attention to right here.
Don't mind Noi. I think he partially blames people from your quadrant for some of the Krennan's troubles. After all, if Voyager hadn't restored the Vadwar, they would have never been in a position to ally with the Iconians. But there is no reason to dwell on past hurts. We're trying to fix what we can here, and then learn to accept the rest. Noi funnels that passion to help his people into his work. Perhaps it will change everything.
We'll all need to work together to defeat the Iconians.
It is a pleasure to meet you. Both Captain Nog and Seven speak highly of you.
Noi doesn't seem to like us much.
Don't mind Noi. I think he partially blames people from your quadrant for some of the Krennan's troubles.
We just heard that.
After all, if Voyager... It is a pleasure to meet you. Both
Let's
Captain
see.
Nog and Seven speak highly of you.
Excuse me, but I'm not sure I've met anyone from your species before.
My name is Clauda, and I am a Tutarian.
Tutarian?
We're from a region of the Delta Quadrant Voyager never visited, so we haven't had much contact with species from the Alpha and Beta Quadrants until now. However, my world has had close ties with the Krennim for several years. Now that they are actively pursuing temporal technology, I chose to join them and lend whatever assistance I can. I miss my home, but I've made a new one here. Meeting Noi has opened me up to a world beyond my own.
Clauda, Tutarian, important character.
It is a pleasure to meet you.
What do you do here?
I was on Kiana Prime with Noi when we received word of the Vadwar attacks. We had only hours to get the temporal equipment running and remove the population from the time stream. Since then, the focus of my work has been developing more stable data storage. We can see into other timelines, but we need a way to secure the data through temporal shifts so we can preserve information about incursions and their effects. In the case of a catastrophic shift, that data could be used as a map to restore the timeline. It is a pleasure to meet you. Both Captain Nog and Seven speak highly of you.
So what we didn't learn there, and we may learn right after we do this, is that is actually Noi's wife. They are married. We might learn that right after we run this program. I forget when it's revealed.
This is an absolute disaster. I had thought that Admiral Tuvok was being pessimistic about the chance for success here. But now, I think he was right.
Alliance making isn't a quick process.
No, it's not. The hierarchy started setting these people against one another before Admiral Tuvok and his team could start to pull them together. The very fact that they all agreed to be in the same room is a minor miracle.
Do you think you can bring them together?
Eventually. Between Vulcan logic, Klingon tenacity, and Romulan pragmatism, we'll convince everyone here that the threat is real and an alliance is in their best interest. But it won't be easy. Now, if you'll excuse me, I see I have another argument to break up.
Okay, good luck, Ambassador.
We've always tried to be good neighbors and treat other races with respect. But this is really too much. The Malon are using our system as a dump, and their trash isn't our problem.
You have a right to be concerned, but please calm down. Or what do you think about the hierarchy becoming more aggressive?
The Malon claim the hierarchy are harassing them, but they're targeting our ships too. So I don't know what to believe, but there are rumors. Trader talk, you know how it is. But I've heard it a lot lately. They say the hierarchy are capturing people and selling them to another race for experiments or as food. We've always tried to be good neighbors and treat other races with respect, but this is really too much. The Malon are using our system as a dump, and their trash isn't our problem.
The Malon aren't the biggest danger to your people.
The Malon might not be the biggest threat, but they are the most immediate. Wait until they start dumping their trash in your front yard and see how you like it.
Okie dokie.
Are you here to preach about responsible waste management too? You can save it. I have a commitment to my people and my planet that supersedes any other concerns.
What do you think of the hierarchy?
I don't want to talk about the hierarchy. They're nothing but trouble. That's part of the reason we're looking for new dumping grounds. I've lost too many ships in the past year. Half a generation of valuable and desperately needed haulers. They're just gone. And I know the hierarchy is to blame. Are you here to preach about responsible waste management?
The Talaxians are concerned.
You can save it. How dare you dictate how we should behave?
He didn't like that.
The disposal of hazardous waste is a noble sacrifice my people make on behalf of their families. Who are you to cheapen their sacrifice? What we do is none of your business. Are you here to preach about... We don't need outsiders telling us what to do. If the Talaxians want to talk, they can come to us directly.
Wow. Okay, so everybody is, like, mad at each other. The Malon have resisted attempts to accept less hazardous waste management practice and continue dumping waste throughout the quadrant. The most at-risk populations are the Talaxians, who have had a new colony close to Malon dumping grounds. The Malon have moved into Talaxian space to avoid hierarchy attacks. Diplomatic relations between the Malon and the Talaxians are rapidly deteriorating. The Malon have accused the Talaxians of working with the hierarchy, a charge the Talaxians strenuously deny. Analysis: the Benthans could potentially pressure the Malon to return to the negotiation table.
Yes, what is your question? I am rather busy. The Hazari are stepping up their smuggling operations, and the Hierarchy's new drive for profits has created a significant increase in attacks on unaligned transports.
Let's see. Would the Benthans be willing to assist the Talaxians in their negotiations with the Malon?
We have enough to do at the moment without getting into a dispute that doesn't concern us. The Hierarchy is harassing our supply lines, and I'm convinced they're behind the losses we've taken over the past 3 months. We're having to double up patrols, which means we're leaving holes the Hazari can slip through. The Malon are a headache we don't need.
I found that working with allies usually brings about positive
results. Yes, what is your question?
What do you think of the Hierarchy?
The Hierarchy's surveillance measures are the best in the quadrant, and that's left us more exposed than I would like. We're losing ships. Once or twice we found debris with Hierarchy weapon signatures, but they're cautious. It's like they can smell traps. Yes, what is
your
question?
Sorry to trouble you, I'll talk
to the Hazari.
Good luck
with that. The Hazari aren't interested in anything but making deals. This whole meeting is just a waste of time. Unity might work where you come from, but I don't have any reason to cooperate with criminals like the Hazari or thugs like the Hierarchy.
Okay. Talk to the Hazari.
What do you want? Did the Benthans make you one of their little deputies? Or was it the Malon? Before everyone broke ties with the Hierarchy, they told us what people say about us. Mercenaries. Honorless. Ha! They all deny it. But we know. Now we look out for ourselves.
Would you be willing to pull out of Benthan space?
No. We need to make a living, same as the rest of you. If the Benthans would take out the Hierarchy on our borders, we wouldn't be forced to move into Benthan's space. But no, they won't do that. They don't think mercenaries rate protection.
Sounds like you should be working with the Benthans, not against them.
What do you want?
Did the what Benthans do you think of the hierarchy?
Make troublemakers? They make our jobs harder and easier. They watch everyone. We used to trade for information from them, but now they won't sell. If we can capture one of their ships, it's like a treasure hoard of information. Makes hunting bounties real easy. But it's harder to take out their ships. I hear they're getting upgrades. And it's not just their ships. Stories going around about one captain whose arm was ripped off by a hierarchy commander. Used to be they'd run from fights. Now they start them.
Now that doesn't sound like the hierarchy I know.
What do you want?
Well,
did the Benthans?
I guess we're done.
Run back to the Benthans. I'll be here if you want to talk business.
Kay, the ambassador.
Unraveling this mess could take months, years.
Yep. Okay, so basically, the hierarchy have become very powerful in this part of space. So, the number of planets the hierarchy have taken outright has increased 20% over the past 6 months. A push for higher profits has promoted steady growth of hierarchy territory. Reports of abductions in areas near hierarchy space have increased. Sounds like the Alachi. However, this data has not been confirmed by outside sources because few Delta Quadrant species are willing to share information with the Federation. Ship's log. Our allies in the Kiana system have been invaded by hierarchy forces. The Kiana colony is a small farming community with no strategic value, so the attack simply doesn't make sense. According to the one survivor who managed to find the hierarchy, we're working with the Alachi. The Alachi took captives to an unknown location. Long-range sensors are detecting both Herald and Iconian readings. While they do not appear to be in active conflict with Alliance forces, you're seeing more ships than normal. There are both Herald and Iconian signals in hierarchy space. It appears the Heralds may be using that area as a staging ground for a coordinated attack with the hierarchy on high-value targets. Yep, so basically, instead of the Vodwar, the Iconians or Heralds have teamed up with the hierarchy in this part of space. So all that's happened is they replaced the Vodwar with the hierarchy. All that dialogue just to say that. They could have done that in like 5 seconds. So yeah, that didn't work. Next.
Damn, that was useless. The Iconians were so determined to have a hold here that they simply found another species to fit the bill. Maybe if you had been a better negotiator, you would have been able to unite those representatives against the hierarchy. Then at least we would have had a chance.
But it would have been the same thing we just did. We did unite those people against the Vodwar, and we took the Vodwar out, but the Iconians still attacked.
This scenario isn't as catastrophic as trying to remove the Iconians, but it's not exactly ideal either. We'll have to try something else.
Excuse my husband's harsh demeanor.
There you go, husband.
This has been a very trying time for the Krenim. Thank you for helping us get this far. We'll keep working.
So there you go. Clauda is a Teutarian and husband of Noi. Very interesting information we need to keep in our heads because things are gonna happen. Thank you.
Trust my wife to be the voice of reason. Perhaps I was too hard on you. I just want to be able to fix all of this. We can't turn back time, but we can change it. Please, speak to Gamma Team. Captain Nog thinks very highly of their plan.
See, it's because of his wife that he's able to back down and apologize and be a nice Noi. So his wife helps him be a better person. Let's see, we need to talk to this person.
Hello, we've been waiting for you. Our team is focusing on delaying tactics. What if Iconia had never been discovered? In 2365, Captain Donald Varley of the USS Yamato found a star chart on Danias 3 that revealed the location of Iconia. I want to redirect a meteor to impact the archaeological site on Danias 3 before Captain Varley begins his excavations. Iconia will remain a myth, and we will not attract the Iconians' attention as early as we did.
But that's just a delay. Another gateway was found a few years later.
True. But if you compare the changes in Iconian technology over the past 200,000 years with what the rest of us have done in the past two centuries, it's obvious that the Iconian culture has stagnated while we have advanced rapidly. Additionally, there are other factors in play that could trigger the alliances and sharing of technology that have come about because of the Iconian threat. It's a risk, but it's one that could pay off. The program is set for Romulan space. Because the Hobus supernova was caused by direct Iconian interference, we expect Romulus to be intact in this new reality. As such, the Romulan Star Empire should once again be a major power in the Quadrant. Your role will be as an officer on a Romulan warbird.
Okay, restore the Romulan Star Empire?
Yes. To call it a huge change would be an understatement. Please be aware that nothing will be done unless the Republic agrees this is the best possible solution. There is already a team here working on the possible restoration of Romulus, and Commander Jurak has been authorized to speak for the Republic if needed. The fact that our data shows delaying the Iconian arrival will also save Romulus is an interesting coincidence, but it does not mean we will accept the solution without looking at other options.
Okay, I see.
The program is set for Romulan space.
Let's go see what happens. I like the idea of trying to delay the Iconian thing. Sounds like the right thing to do. Speak with Commander Tamir, which is not here. Hey, that rhymes. Where are you, Tamir?
Ah, Sub-Commander. I'd like to test out some new security passcodes. If you'd be so kind as to seal the doors and disable certain, equipment, we need to talk.
Oh. Well, that's not suspicious at all. I like how he knows the equipment's here anyway, knows where it is, and apparently I know how to disable it.
Thank you for playing along, Sub-Commander. The Tal Shiar can't hear us now. I need to talk to you about Datan and the Separatists. They've been located near the Dewa system. What we do next could change our future.
The only thing I know about the Separatists is what I've heard through official channels. What do you know? Or you're not asking if we should attack them, are you? What do you know?
Datan has been inspired by Spock's teaching. He and many others have left the homeworld and are gathered together in a flotilla somewhere near Tal Dewa. Datan and his allies have been making overtures of peace to both the Federation and the Klingons. Because of this, they have enough support that even the Tal Shiar won't take direct action against them. The Borg are at our borders. The Empire can't fight the Collective and the Separatists at the same time.
All right.
Thank you for playing along, Sub-Commander. The Tal Shiar can't hear us now. I need to talk to you about Datan and the Separatists.
All right,
you're
not asking me if we should attack them, are you?
If I was, I wouldn't have needed you to lock the door. I intend to put Lieutenant Salon in the brig, and then take this ship and crew to join the Separatists. Are you with me?
Sure.
I know. I have tried to work within the system, but the system is broken and corrupt. Datan and his people are building something better. You and I both know it. The crew knows it. We will take this warbird to Datan, and we will finally be free.
Okay, well, let's be free. Unseal door. Confront Salon.
Secret conversations between the commander and one of his senior officers? Very suspicious. Loyal citizens of the Romulan Star Empire have no need for locked doors.
I'm going to have to ask you to accompany the security team to the brig.
Tamir, you are a fool, and you will be the death of everyone on this ship. Datan and his people are terrorists. If you join them, you will share their fate.
You are under arrest. Please comply, and you will not be harmed. So, this is good news. I mean, everybody still goes to Datan, and the whole Romulan Republic thing
still
happens.
My friends, it is time we forge our own destiny. A destiny free from the tyranny of the Tal Shiar. If we leave, we will have a better, brighter future than what they would allow us. I know this is a step into the unknown, but it is a step we will take together. Throw off your chains. We will join our brothers and sisters in freedom.
Yay. So that's all positive so far.
I wanted to let you know that I am with you and Commander Temer. Some of my family has left Romulus to join Datan. I'll be proud to join them.
Sounds great. Let's see what's up. Notice all hands, the seminar, traitors in our midst, the historical execution of traitors to the Star Empire has been moved to 2100 hours. Okay, quadrant status report. Notice all ship commanders, Starfleet vessels have been assisting new Romulans in areas near the neutral zone. Imperial ships are being dispatched in a show of force. Any ships harboring or assisting the Separatists are to be fired upon. There are no exceptions. Ships in Group Gamma are being reassigned to patrols in the area targeted by the Borg. Contacts are regular, but vigilance is needed to eradicate the threat and protect our colony worlds. Personal log. Gaius is becoming suspicious. I've been speaking to members of the senior staff, and most are in favor of making a run for the flotilla and joining the Tun. But I remain cautious. They are doing the right thing, but the Borg are nipping at our heels. Every ship the fleet loses might be one needed to protect Romulus in its hour of need, but what is there left to protect? Long-range sensors show no Herald or Iconian signatures, and there are no references to Heralds in the ship's database. The only references to the Iconians are in the historical files, and most refer to the Iconians as a myth. There are heightened levels of Borg activity throughout the Beta Quadrant, and multiple colony worlds have been assimilated. The Romulan fleets are on high alert, but have not been able to make major inroads against the Collective, so for some reason, there's a heightened Borg activity because of this change. I don't know what would cause that. Maybe the Iconians had a war with the Borg somewhere in the past and kind of depleted their forces. And if they hadn't have been there, now they're more powerful. Something like that, maybe.
That is the most promising simulation yet. It appears there was some merit to our hypothesis that the Iconians advanced their plans due to early contact.
But it's not perfect.
The readings do indicate higher levels of Borg activity, but it should be an acceptable risk.
Do you think this could be our solution?
The data in this simulation does show higher Borg activity than we're currently seeing, but there are no signs of Herald, Iconian, or Solanae presence at all. And while the Romulan Star Empire is restored to their former power, there is a democratic Romulan group opposing the Tal Shiar. And more importantly, Romulus is intact. This is the result many of our Romulan researchers have been trying to bring about.
Indeed, it would solve like a lot of problems. But this isn't our reality. We'll be significantly altering everything we know.
The political calculus of the Quadrant will change, but the data supports what you saw on the holodeck. No Iconians. We have solid projections. The only suggestion I have now is that you consider it in conjunction with Captain Nog and the Republic representatives here.
I'll discuss it with them, but I'm not making any promises.
This last test has the most promising results I've seen, and saving the Romulan homeworld is an added bonus. We're not going to have a lot of shots at this. I've been looking at Anorex's work, and I think it's too easy to get into a temporal loop where you try again and again for a specific result, and time starts fighting back. I'm inclined to say this is our best chance. But this will have a huge impact on the reality we know, especially your people, Commander Jirok. I won't give my authorization without hearing from everyone.
We can't move forward without considering the effects of on the Republic, Commander.
This is difficult. It would change everything for us. We'd have our home back, but the Republic, everything we've built, it would all be gone. But there's still hope. Even in this other reality, Datan has led many Romulans away from Sela and her Tal Shiar thugs.
Yep.
The simulation specifically mentioned Datan and a separatist movement. Commander Temer makes the choice to join Datan, the same choice he made after the homeworld was lost. With Romulus, we could have numbers. More people who have had enough of the Tal Shiar's oppression could join us. Maybe millions more. If Datan is able to get a movement going, even at the height of the Empire's power, I have to believe that change is possible. Make the incursion. Okay. The lives we save will be worth the work we'll have to do to reform the Republic. The Tal Shiar wasn't able to stop us the first time. They won't stop us again.
If the Romulan Republic thinks it's worth the risk, then we should try it. Sir, we have been informed that the Lisette and the Krynim vessel will be traveling with us to the site of the temporal incursion. The Krynim vessel has the weapon on board, and the Lisette will provide additional security and manpower if needed. What? We're going to do this now? See, I think this is completely just, way too soon. I mean, hold on now. Let's run a few more simulations just to make sure. And let's also, like, maybe, I don't know, sit down and have a meeting with everybody in the galaxy before we do this. Or at least the quadrant, or at least this part of space. The alpha, beta, gamma, delta quadrants. Well, that would be the whole galaxy, wouldn't it? I mean, seriously, we need to, like, you know, kind of, like, talk to everybody and say, hey, guys, guess what? So, we got this plan, but it's going to kind of change reality for, like, the entire galaxy. The Borg are going to be a bigger threat. That's a thing we need to consider. So, like, let's talk about this and see if we really want to do this. But no, hey, let's just go jump into this right now and just do it right now. Jeez. All three vessels will be temporarily shielded to protect us from changes. Yeah. It doesn't matter, though. We need to, like, talk to people. Like, tell them we're about to do this. Ask if they want us to do this. Like, what the heck? We're just going to go do it? We don't even know the consequences yet. I mean, it's like, we came up with one solution that worked out of three, and we're taking the first one. We're like, taking it. No way. You've got to run multiple simulations. You've got to try different things. Maybe we can have our cake and eat it too if we just try a little harder. You know, you get three options and went with the third one. That was it. I mean, that's it. You took like maybe 10 minutes to figure it out. Not good, my friend. Not good. Jumping the gun much? They deserve what happens to them. Because they just jumped into this. Like, just jumped right into this thing. Like, this is the answer. Let's do it. Increase Borg
target
activity.
Target acquired and locked.
Who cares? Wow.
Activating weapon.
There it goes. They're doing it.
Incursion
it's the thing.
Complete.
Here it comes.
It will be good to see the world of my birth again.
Temporal incursion, but these ships are temporarily shielded, except nobody else is.
Elements? Is that Romulus?
Yep.
It's been assimilated. Completely assimilated.
Good job, team. That wasn't in your simulations, was it?
Yes. See? I think we have a problem.
Something went wrong between the simulation and what
no.
really
we
happened.
We expected to see some Borg activity, but this can't be right.
So your simulation must have been wrong.
I agree that this is unexpected, Commander, but we knew there would be anomalies.
You didn't test it enough.
We need more information. Let's find out where the simulation might have gone wrong.
Well, it's not a simulation now, guys. This is real life. Stay on the edge of the system.
The whole system can't be assimilated, can it?
Probably.
That is a lot of Borg.
I don't have a cloaking device. Send the Romulan ship, they can cloak.
According to these scans, the planet has been completely assimilated. I'm not detecting any non-Borg life signs. This is bad. Really, really bad. We need to fix this.
Maybe you should have tested it a little more before we just jumped into it.
Borg ships decloaking! Red alert!
Great, the Borg have cloaks now. That's just what we need.
First the Klingons, now the Borg. Does everyone steal cloaking technology?
Target shield has failed.
Borg reinforcements. reinforcements on an intercept course.
Like this one? Whoa, okay, I'm dead. Don't know what that was, but I'm gone. That was quick. Well, that was fun.
We need more information before we can fix this. I'll keep the Krenim ship well out of Borg sensor range while you go in and find out what happened. Hurry, more Borg will be arriving soon.
Oh, great.
I've modified
some
personal shield generators to shield you temporally as well. I'm transporting them over now. Hurry, the temporal shielding drains a lot of power. You won't have much time down there before you're unprotected. If that happens, this will be your new reality.
Wonderful. Okay, Clouda says she is concerned about the weapon. We probably only have one more shot before the capacitors burn out. So we need to get this right. Well, if you only had two shots in the whole thing, why did we start this now? These people don't think things through. They're very impulsive, aren't they?
We need more data to plot a possible solution. With any luck, the Borg will have what we need. Maybe. Our focus is on restoration. There is a computer node in this area of the Unimatrix that should have what we need. Find the node and download all the data you can from the point where we made our incursion. That should help us find out how-
I'm going to join you. I know this place. Or at least I knew this place.
I need to put on my thingy, frequency remodulator, because I don't have a remodulating set. We're fighting the Borg, so gotta get ready for that. There we go. I should probably put one on my bridge officers, but I don't want to worry about it right now. They might already have one on. Yeah, they already have one on anyway. Frequency remodulators. So that's all good.
The whole planet. All our people. They're Borg.
Duh. Well, that
I can't believe we were so wrong.
I can. You only did one simulation. I would have liked run it again. Let's double check our figures.
Cover me. I'll override the door controls.
Or go to other places in the galaxy and find out what other, how that affected other areas and other places. They just went to like one area, determined, well, yeah, this is the right thing to do for the entire galaxy.
Got it.
Takes so long to remodulate with this.
We have to find a way to make this right.
I got an egg.
Resistance is futile.
I win an egg.
There. That's the access node console we need. Locked. We'll have to circumvent their security measures. Wait! Incoming Borg!
Enemy targets on sensors.
The whole facility is a Borg.
When we lost the homeworld, I thought that was the worst thing that could happen to us.
You will be assimilated.
This was Romulan technology once, but it's been completely assimilated.
Yes, thank you, Captain Obvious.
Hakeev?
You will become one with the Borg. Resistance is futile.
Those ones aren't even fully assimilated. Why can't I get my security escorts out? Dead now, thank you. For some reason, I can't get my security escorts out.
Enemy targets on sensors.
Let's get all this loot. Wonderful, wonderful loot.
Enemy combatants in close proximity. Enemy targets on sensors.
Input query. Drone 2 reporting alcove, reporting section, manifold 35, regeneration, breakdown records of years. Romulus system added to the collective. Unimatrix established in orbit of Romulus. All adjuncts of Unimatrix redesignated into Trimatrixes.
It looks like the main invasion of Romulan space occurred about 20 years ago. Something happened in the Delta Quadrant. The Borg assimilated something that greatly improved their technology. They adapted, evolved, and my people, they didn't have a chance. Maybe it's our fate to lose Romulus.
Wonder what they assimilated in the Delta Quadrant. Don't know what could have been there that they assimilated. All we can do now is try to restore the previous timeline. Maybe this will help. Well, maybe. I don't know. Next. Download data. I did that.
We need more data to plot a possible solution.
I'm going to join you. I know the controls ahead of us will unlock the bulkheads.
Oh. I guess I didn't do the dialogue I needed to do. I just did the whole mission without the dialogue. Okay.
Let's get out of here. There are more than 20 Borg ships on an intercept course.
Yeah, 20 is a lot.
More Borg on the way.
Yeah, you just said that. 20 of them.
Borg decloaking!
Where?
Warning. Ship is under attack. Four shields failing. Rear shields failing. Right shields failing.
This.
Transmit the data!
Focus on your repairs. We will make sure the data is preserved. Data is compressed and ready. Communications array is ready. Secure channel confirmed.
Ship is under attack.
Data received!
I'm running the numbers now. If we target the Borg transwarp network, the Borg may never be able to reach Romulus.
It is a great risk. The Borg have a great deal of influence on the timeline. There is no time to run simulations.
Do we have a choice?
We do not.
Okay, they're doing it again. Here it goes.
Targeting the transwarp network.
Firing the weapon! Now!
Nope, that's gone. And so is Romulus.
The Borg are gone. But so is Romulus.
Romulus isn't the only thing we lost. Temporal shielding is failing.
What happened?
The Borg did too much damage to the generators. If we lose the temporal shielding, we'll all reintegrate with the timeline.
Has anything else changed?
Checking. No. The Deuterians. They're gone.
What? How?
I see the problem. 20 years ago, your people tried to replicate the work of the Solanae to protect themselves from the Borg. In this timeline, they failed.
Temporal shield is at 8%.
No, I need to restabilize the shields.
I'm downloading my personal files into the shielded core. You'll have all my research notes and everything we've recorded from this mission.
You're giving up? When the shield fails, if the Deuterians were lost in the past, then you'll be lost too.
Temporal shield is losing integrity.
Is there anything we can do?
No, we all knew the risks. I love.
Uh-oh. She went bye-bye. Well, now we are part of the timeline. This timeline. Now, isn't this the increased Borg activity timeline? I mean, think about it. All that they did was destroy the transwarp gate so that the Borg could not get to Romulus. But they were still in the timeline of the... I mean, the Borg were still a big threat, even though they've stopped the Borg from coming to Romulus. The Borg are still a big threat. That didn't change that aspect of the timeline. So now we should be stuck in a timeline where the Borg are a bigger threat if you go by logic. But I know that's not the case because I know what happens. But, I mean, that is what should have happened. They've just totally screwed up everything. So the original timeline is the Deuterians being alive.
We found a temporally shielded computer core, and it shows two uses of the Krenim weapon. But as far as I know, the Iconians are still out there. We changed the timeline, but we didn't fix our most important problem.
How different is the world now?
We won't be sure until we finish analyzing the data, but the Krenim weapon was used twice. I remember being on the bridge of the Krenim ship and seeing a readout with a far lower power reserve than had just been there a moment before. I'm sure you had a similar situation.
Sure, I did.
As to the greater differences, we'll know more soon. I only hope the ripples from what we did today don't start a tsunami. We found a temporally shielded computer core, and it shows two uses of the Krenim. We haven't dug that far into the data yet, and it will take some in-depth investigation to catalog all of the changes. Noi is going to lead the group taking care of that. I will say it is odd to find personal logs I don't remember making. Very. But from what we've already seen, it appears the reason the weapon was fired twice was because we had to try to correct a change we made. Technology like this seems so simple, but even the smallest change can make more trouble than it solves. We have to be more cautious. Far more cautious than we've already been, I suppose. The next mistake might not be fixable. Time alteration might not be the answer. There are some problems that can't be solved with a weapon. But time travel. Look, whatever happens, it was good working with you. I hope we have the chance to do so in the future.
Good working with you. All right, here's something to think about the timeline here now. Hold on, I got a text message. I must check this. Oh, okay. All right. So here's the deal, right? Okay. They first destroyed an asteroid. The asteroid is now forever gone in that timeline, and the second timeline, and the third timeline. Let's call them three timelines, all right? The first timeline is where we started from. I wish I could draw this out for you, like on a piece of paper, but you can't see me, so I'm drawing it in the air, so follow my finger. The first timeline is the original one we started from. The second timeline is when they destroyed the asteroid. The Borg were a bigger threat. Romulus was assimilated. The third timeline, Romulus is destroyed again, and the Borg did not assimilate Romulus because all they did is destroy a transwarp gate so that the Borg could not get to Romulus. Ergo, there's a big word for you, ergo, in this third timeline, the Borg threat should still remain. The Borg should have a heightened threat from the second timeline. Now, in the first timeline, the Borg were not as much of a threat, but the second timeline, they were, and that should be carried over to the third timeline because all they changed was deleting the transwarp gate so that the Borg couldn't get to New Romulus, but the Borg outside of New Romulus, outside of the solar system and the other parts of the galaxy, would not have been affected by that. Removing that transwarp gate would not have affected the other Borg at this point in time. They would still be very powerful out there, having assimilated other worlds. Also, that asteroid that they destroyed in timeline number one is still destroyed in timeline number two and timeline number three. The asteroid cannot come back to life. It destroys it completely from the timeline. It never existed in the first place, is what this weapon does. Therefore, that asteroid should have be destroyed in the second and this third timeline that we're in now. Which means, again, the Borg should be a heightened Borg. They should be more powerful. Also, I know that's not what's actually happening, but I mean, that's not what has actually happened, but I think that the writers missed kind of that point or part of it. Also, the Tutarians, they were alive in the first timeline, the original one, but then in the second timeline, they were still alive because they didn't say anything about the Tutarians being gone in that second timeline. Although they could have been and just not mentioned it. Now in the third timeline, they're gone. But I do wonder how that happened, because if all they did was destroy a transwarp gate so the Borg couldn't get to New Romulus in this third timeline, how would that have affected the Tutarians? I guess it wouldn't have. So I'm guessing, oh, I accidentally hit a button and there's my security escorts. I'm guessing that the Tutarians were actually destroyed in the second timeline and that was carried over to the third. That would make more sense, because simply destroying a transwarp gate so the Borg couldn't get to Romulus would not have affected the Tutarians in the Delta Quadrant at all. But in the second timeline, with the Borg having reached the Beta Quadrant and having Romulus assimilated, could have assimilated and defeated the Tutarians in that timeline. So I think that's a carryover. That's why I also think the heightened Borg thing should also be a carryover from the second timeline. Because if the Tutarians were destroyed in the second timeline, both of those things should be carried over. If one was carried over, then the other one should be. That's my way of thinking there. So just some things to note here, how the timeline has changed and, I don't know, gone weird. But there's some inconsistency in the storyline, and I think that's just on the part of the writers here for not realizing some of those things or not writing about it, because I think that certain things had to have happened or changed. That, I mean, we're not just in a different timeline now, we're in like two different timelines. We have completely changed reality. This is no longer the prime universe of Star Trek. If you think about it, if you just really, really think about it, this is no longer the prime universe of Star Trek. I mean, we are in a completely different timeline outside of the Star Trek we have known and loved. You could say that. You could say that. That would make sense if you said that.
We've put so much hope into using the Krenim technology to solve our problems. Perhaps I was caught up in the possibilities and blind to the potential for disaster. We tried and we failed. But this isn't the end. We'll keep looking at the simulations as well as any other option open to us. I have to have faith that we will find a way to defeat the Iconians.
Okay.
I was conducting another simulation, and all of a sudden I got an emergency call telling me to stop everything. I will be looking at whatever data we managed to save to try and determine what went wrong. Maybe we can try again after we know more.
I hope you find
something. It has been good to have you here. But we will have to consider if time alteration is really the best course of action. Of all the records we have of time travel, few have as drastic a result as this. Perhaps removing elements from the time stream isn't the solution we need.
You're just now thinking this? Y'all were so impulsive to use the device in the first place, and now you're thinking it's not a good idea? Noi sure has changed. He's got a beard. Remember, he did not have a beard before in the first timeline.
I have a lot of information to analyze. The shielded core appears to have made it through the process intact, and will give us a wealth of data on the timeline and how the changes have affected it. Clearly, you made a mistake somewhere. I still feel this is the best technology available to us, but we will need minds sufficient to the task to operate it.
Well, he's angry at us. Sir, I'm concerned about using time travel to solve this situation. And it's interesting, they're so concerned about using time travel to solve the situation, yet what's the answer going to be in the next mission, everybody? Time travel. They contradict themselves. Everybody in this game is a contradiction of themselves.
Captain Nog tells me that the initial test of the Krenim weapon was less than promising. He says that he and his team have a great deal of data still to analyze, but I do not believe they will find much that will assist us. Removing elements from the time stream is reckless, and while our options are limited, we should not destroy ourselves in a fruitless effort to destroy the Iconians. It is time to consider all of our alternatives.
Okay, well, let's take a reward. Let's start with the temporal disentanglement suite. Now, I'm going to walk through some of these. My phone's doing things. We'll talk through some of these other things while they're right here. The temporal phase overcharge warp core does additional auxiliary power. That would be good as a science officer. It improves power transfer rate and improves power levels when low. It shows warp core efficiency. It adds 7.5% of your aux power to your shield power, and auxiliary power and recharge buff. So this warp core would be very good for a science character or a science ship. But this is not a warp core that's really going to benefit us as far as a tactical character with an escort. However, there is this thing where it has anti-chronoton infused. It's got it doesn't actually list the bonuses right now. I'd have to get one of these items so I can list the bonuses, but I'm thinking maybe one of the bonuses associated with this is some kind of tetrion damage. Maybe, I'm not sure. I definitely do want the omnidirectional. I'll just go ahead and get this one first, actually. The omnidirectional anti-chronoton infused tetrion beam. This is going to go in the back of my ship. I'm going to replay this to get the temporal disentanglement suite. Why do I want that? Because check this out. My critical chance and severity are both increased based on my auxiliary power, and that's very important for a tactical character or an escort, increasing that critical chance and critical severity. So however powerful my aux power is will help my critical chance and critical severity. And it also does some other things, like a little more aux power and reduces damage to shields by 3%, but that's very minor. What I want it for is that extra critical chance and critical severity. That's going to help us do more damage. So I'm going to get that next, but let's go for the omnidirectional anti-chronoton beam now. Because I definitely want to put that on my ship. So let's just do this on screen. Let's go to Soul System Transwarp. And I will put this thing on my ship. Have the other piece there on the end that I want. And then I'll pretty much have my aft weapon slots all fixed up here. So here's the beam. No upgrades that I can do right now. We'll take this beam out. I'm going to take this and put it back here. So this is going to do... this is going to do 421 DPS to self, negative 10 weapon power and firing other weapons, 2.5 chance of the Omega weapon amplifier, direct energy weapons, create one level 61 chronoton mine. Look at all that stuff there. It's got associated with it. 2.5 chance of 527 Tetrion damage, ignore shields, doubled, and pierces resistance versus heralds. So that's pretty nice. And plus 10% accuracy on this thing. There, so there it is. There's the Krenim Temporal Manipulation set. You need the Phase Overcharge Core and the Disentanglement Console. Now, I'm going to have the Disentanglement Console, but I'm not going to have the Phase Overcharged Core. But let's see what would happen if we did. The two-piece bonus, here we go. So I definitely at least want two pieces of this, because that does give me a plus 13.3% Tetrion damage. That's very important for my character. That's just going to give me even more Tetrion damage. I'm going to have all my tactical consoles maxed out with Tetrion damage. And then at the same time, I'm going to have the two-piece bonus from the Temporal Manipulation set that's also going to increase Tetrion damage. So I'm going to be doing Tetrion damage out the wazoo. I'm looking forward to that. The third-piece bonus is called an Anti-Chronoton-Infused Tetrion Discharge. I'm not going to have that because I'm not going to use the Warp Core. I'm going for the Iconian Warp Core. So, therefore, I won't have this three-piece bonus, but it's the two-piece bonus that's going to benefit me better anyway, because that's going to be more Tetrion damage for my Tetrion weapons. So that I am highly looking forward to. And that's when I'm going to get rid of the timeline stabilizer, and I'll put the disentanglement suite here. And then I'll have that two-piece bonus giving me more Tetrion damage. That's going to make this ship rock. So this next console I get is not only going to increase my critical chance, critical severity, it's also going to increase my Tetrion damage. Holy crap. And now I have three 360-degree beams on the back. You know what that means, folks? Every time I fire forward now with my ship, all of my weapons are firing at once. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 weapons will fire on the enemy and hit them and do damage when I forward fire. 7 weapons at a time. I'm going to have 3 dual beam banks, a torpedo, and then 3 single beams, or 2 single beams and 1 kinetic beam, hitting the enemy at once when I forward fire. That's power, folks. That's power. And with when I get that other console, I will also be doing more damage with it as well. I'll have my tactical consoles increasing the Tetrion damage, plus the two-piece bonus from the set I'm going to have increasing my Tetrion damage even more. It's like having 6 tactical consoles. And more critical chance and critical severity on top of all that, based on my auxiliary power setting. Holy crap, guys. This next console is just going to boost my ship up like that. And once I finish the Iconian set, I'll be able to have that stacking damage buff that it has. And on top of that, it has a team buff, which gives you like plus 30% damage on top of that when you activate that power that it has. So holy crap, guys, this ship can get a whole lot better, and this character can, and we're about to. I am getting there. It's going to be one powerful, and this is free to play. I haven't spent one dime on this game, and I am building up a powerful build here. This is going to be very nice. I'm highly looking forward to it. Anyway, kind of impressed by that. I'm liking it. It's all going to be very good. Well, like I said, I need to replay this mission. It's a very long mission, Butterfly. And I need to replay Time in a Bottle and Broken Circle as well. So I've got a lot of replays to do. But I am going to do that. I want to get everything I can. I want to get it all before I do midnight. So I'm probably going to replay all these missions before we get to midnight so that I am fully equipped with what I can do, you know, up to this point. I won't have the full Iconian set, but I will have the full Crinum. I'll have that Crinum set for the, you know, Tetrion damage and all that I just talked about. So I will have all of that for midnight. Plus the new beam I just got. So it's all going to be good. I'm very, very happy. All right. Thank you, guys. Stay tuned. It may take me a couple of days because, like I said, I need to replay all those missions before I do the next one. So the next one may not come out till Friday because I need a little bit of time to replay those missions. But that's my plan. So give me a couple of days for the next mission. Thank you all for watching and stay tuned for the next one.